Good morning, my friends. Good morning. God's grace and blessings be with you as we worship on this beautiful day. We get to come to God's house today, and on this Sunday is the beginning of a journey. On this Sunday is the season of Advent, and not everybody's familiar with what that means, but as you come in, do you notice how beautiful the sanctuary is? And we should thank you, Jan, for such a beautiful job. Once again, beautiful, beautiful. But you know that things are a little different, right? And that's why it is a reminder of why this time of year is different. And when we see these sights and we see these decorations and when we hear certain music and sounds, we know that something special is happening. And that's Advent. Something special is happening, and you got to open your heart, and you got to open your eyes, and you got to be ready to receive it. And so as we come to worship today, I pray that you receive God's wondrous grace and his love for you. As we worship today, my friends, let us be grateful for God's grace in Jesus Christ. Would you join with me in our call to worship? A voice cries out in the wilderness, "Prepare the way of the Lord. Every valley will be filled, every rocky path will be smoothed. See the light from on high, the dawn is breaking. Would you pray with me? Our gracious heavenly Lord, it is good to gather together with your name on our lips and with the strength of faith in our hearts. This is a new season for worship and a time for us to renew our hope in you. You are coming again, Lord, and we believe beyond any doubt that your light will shine in the darkness. We long for your peace, knowing that one day your glorious presence will fill us with your perfect love. So help us to use these days to prepare well and to live our lives knowing that you are coming soon. Make us to be faithful and obedient to you. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Our opening song, "The King of Glory Comes." Would you stand as we sing together?
God's people said, amen. You may be seated as we begin our lighting of our Advent candle. First, we're going to sing our Advent song, just verse one.
Light the Advent candle. Started on our way, time to think of Christmas Day. Candle, candle, burning bright, shining in the cold winter night. Candle, candle, burning
And now I invite Janetta to come up for the Advent reading.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Today begins the Advent season. The word Advent means waiting, and it comes before any Christmas celebration because this season reminds us to get ready for the coming of our Lord. As we light our first Advent candle, we are reminded of hope. The prophet Jeremiah said, "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will cause a righteous branch of spring up to David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved. And Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called. The Lord is our righteousness." We light this candle because Jesus Christ is our hope. We trust in our Lord and the light he sends into the dark world. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for our hope, a hope that is named Jesus Christ. Help us to prepare well to receive the coming of our Lord and to live loving, peaceful, and holy lives. We ask this in the name of our Emmanuel. Amen.
Our scripture reading comes from Luke chapter 21, starting with verse 25. "There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." Then he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man." This is the word of the Lord, and we can trust it. Thanks be to God.
Jesus, God sent most us to give light to the world. The star of my life is Jesus. In there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lord is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I want to see the brightness of God. I want to look at Jesus. This one of righteousness will shine in my path and show me the way to the Father. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lord is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I'm looking for the coming of Christ. I want to be with Jesus. When we have run with patience the race, we shall know the joy of Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lord is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus.
Amen. Janet, thank you. Andy, thank you. What a blessing. Amen. Amen. My friends, would you pray with me? Gracious God, we are so grateful to hear that song and that powerful reminder that we are to walk in the light, and not just any light, but your light. And so, God, help us to be attentive to what you say to us today. Help us, Lord, to listen and to be faithful, to always be ready for you. This is our prayer in Christ's holy name. Amen. Okay, so I have a confession I have to make. A big, big confession. I start listening to Christmas music in November.
I heard it.
I do. When November 1st comes around, I'm one of those people. When November 1st comes around, I'm looking for songs about sleigh rides. I'm looking for songs about the winter wonderland. There's even a song out there called Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. And I'll listen to that. Why? Because I can't help it. There's just something special about Christmas music. There's something about it that just lifts my spirits. I love it. And as we think about Christmas music, I bet you have a favorite song. I bet you have one Christmas song that you treasure the most. Maybe it's a secular song. Maybe it's a religious song. But there's probably a Christmas song that you really enjoy listening to. And I'm going to use a Christmas song to help introduce the sermon for today. And I've got several versions on my phone. Probably the largest file of songs, genre songs on my phone is probably Christmas music. And I've got all kinds of versions of this particular Christmas song. I got a version by Burl Ives. Remember Burl? Not that I ever met him personally. Ray Conniff and his singers got that version. But I got this version from Bing Crosby. You remember Bing Crosby? Oh, he could sing. And so I'm wondering if you recognize this song.
You better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why.
Why?
Santa Claus is coming to town, gather round. He's making a list, checking it twice, he's gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town.
All right, you know that song, you've heard that song before? Santa Claus is coming to town. Right. You know, you listen to that song, and that song is about expectation. That song is about anticipating the arrival of someone very, 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 very special, right? And that's what it's about. Parents love that song because it reminds their children that they need to behave, right? You better behave before Christmas. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. And I'm telling you why. Because someone special is coming and you got to be ready. That's the essence of the song. It's about expectations and it's about being ready for the arrival of someone very special. What a great way to talk about what Jesus was saying in our gospel reading, where Jesus told his disciples to be on guard. Jesus told his disciples, you got to be ready. You got to be ready for his return. And so every year, the church spends 4 Sundays getting ready for Christmas. Did you know that? We spend 4 Sundays getting ready for Christmas, and we call it the season of Advent. And with Advent, there are always 2 parts. Did you know that? There are 2 parts to Advent. And with Advent, you have the arrival of our Savior born in Bethlehem, but you also have the strength of hope found in the truth that Christ will come again. So you have 2 Advents. You had the first Advent with the coming of Jesus in Bethlehem. And then you have the second Advent, which is about the second coming or Christ returning as he promised. And so we remember the first Advent. We got that, right? God sent his son to be born for us in Bethlehem. And this baby Jesus grew up and started teaching us and showing us about the kingdom of God. And we pray for this kingdom every week. We probably pray for this kingdom every day in our own prayers, if we ever share the Lord's Prayer. Have you ever prayed the Lord's Prayer? Then in it, you're praying for that kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's the kingdom that Jesus was talking about. And that's what we celebrate in the first Advent. But we also spend time in the Advent season reminding ourselves that, you know, Christ said that he's going to come again, right? That's the second Advent that we anticipate. We long for that moment when Christ is going to come again. And you know what? When Christ comes again, it's not something to fear. It's not something to dread. That's the reign of God's grace and love in the lives of all people. That is the triumph of death and suffering and war. That is where God's will is perfectly done, and we have nothing to fear in our relationship with God. And that's what our scripture is all about. That's what Jesus was talking about. Jesus told his disciples that at some point in the future, he's going to come back. And he tells us to always be ready for that moment. I remember a joke about a mother and daughter who were attending church, and the sermon was about the second coming of Jesus Christ. And that's why the daughter asked, "Mom, when is Jesus coming back?" And the mom said, "Well, I really don't know, sweetie." And the daughter said, "Well, why don't you just Google it? Isn't that the answer today for everything? You don't know? Well, just Google it, right? You Google it on your phone." I happened to Google it yesterday. 241 million responses. Just in typing in, when is Jesus coming back? 241 million options to look at. You see, now that is a lot of speculation. That's a lot of writing. That's a lot of people thinking and talking about it. And there are authors and preachers and theologians who have built entire careers over trying to answer that question. When is Jesus going to come back? But Jesus is very clear about his timing. He said, we will never, never know the exact moment when he will come again. And that's why he said, you got to be ready. You always have to be ready. You have to be on guard. And so we're starting our Advent season with this passage about the second coming of Jesus Christ. And we know that Jesus tried to prepare his disciples for his death and resurrection. And here Jesus is teaching that he's going to come back again, that he's going to return. And that's why Jesus told his disciples, you have to adopt this attitude of watchfulness. You got to watch out. You don't know when he's coming again. It's just like a child eagerly anticipating Christmas morning. They know something special is coming, and they know someone is delivering presents. And you can see that anticipation in the life of a child. And I think that's what Jesus was trying to instill within us. You got to anticipate this, not with fear, but with joy, because something beautiful is coming. And really, that's what the season of Advent is all about. It's about getting ready to welcome the coming of our Lord. And as Christians, you realize that that's what we're supposed to do, right? This is part of our walk of faith, to make sure that we're always ready to welcome the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. As Christians, we want to be found faithful when Christ comes again. I mean, we don't want to put something like that off. But here's the problem. Do you like to wait? Carol and Janetta were the first to shake their heads. Let's take note of that. Do you like waiting? No, we're human beings and we don't like to wait. We especially don't like being kept in the dark. So here's the question. Why doesn't God just share with us that information? Why can't God just tell us, you know, on this day, at this time, woohoo, Jesus is coming again. I think the reason why we're not told is because of this. That God is God and we are not. That's why we don't know. Our thinking and our planning is not even in the same ballpark as God. There was a prophet named Isaiah who said in chapter 55, verse 8, he said, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts." And what he was saying was that God thinks completely differently than we do. We just don't think like God. We don't plan like God. We don't have the same understanding and the same knowledge as God. And so one of the first things that we have to do in the season of Advent is we got to let go of our desire to be in control. And we hate that. Because you know what it means? When you let go of control, do you know what that means that you have to do? It means you have to be patient. And it means you have to wait. And that's what you do when you let go of trying to be in control. Okay, I can't do this. I can't control this. But I have to be patient. I have to wait. I mean, we would love to know what tomorrow might bring. If we could know what tomorrow is going to bring, then we can prepare appropriately. Do you all remember, I know you do, you remember 9/11, September 11th, 2001. And you remember what happened to us as a nation. The people who boarded those planes and the people who went to work in the Twin Towers and in the Pentagon had no idea what that day was going to bring to them. And it's interesting that some missed the tragedy of 9/11 because of various circumstances. There was one gentleman who was late to work to the Twin Towers because it was his morning to stop and pick up the donuts. A woman missed her flight because her alarm clock didn't go off. There was another man who had car troubles. Car wouldn't stop, and so he didn't make it to the Pentagon in time. There's actually a story about a man who bought a new pair of shoes, and as he was walking to work at the Twin Towers, developed a blister on his toe. And so he stopped to buy a Band-Aid. And because of that, he was not at the Twin Towers. How do you explain that? The answer is, you can't. You can't. No one will ever know what the next moment is going to bring. It's not ours to control. And regardless of the writings that you might find in certain theologians and preachers and authors, no one knows the moment when Christ shall come again. All we have is this simple instruction to wait. But while we wait, we are to be ready. And we are to watch in great anticipation, to live ready for Christ's return. I mean, it would be great if Google could tell us what might happen tomorrow. And if we knew the answer to when Jesus would come, we could solve all kinds of problems. You know, we'd be ready. If we knew when Jesus was coming, we'd probably wait till the last minute to make sure everything was in order, right? You know, okay, I got 30 minutes. All right, I can get ready for Jesus. That's not what it's about. It's about living ready now. And that's the hard part. It's hard because, friends, life is messy. Life is hard. Life is uncertain. Life is confusing. And it's easy to become distracted from the way of Christ. We forget who we are. We forget where we draw our strength from. And sometimes we feel trapped in a world of pessimism and despair. Do you remember the story of George Bailey? You ever remember that name, George Bailey? He's in a movie called It's a Wonderful Life. You ever see that movie? What a great movie, right? It's a story about faithfulness. It's a story about family and responsibility, but mostly it's about hope, and it's about God's intervention in our lives. If you remember, George is the main character, and George is one of those great guys that everybody loves. George is the one who gives of himself without expecting any reward. I mean, he's just a good guy. He's easygoing, but a crisis arises in his life, right? A crisis, because the bank examiner is coming and he suddenly finds out that he has a shortfall in his accounting because of a mistake by his Uncle Billy and because of old man Potter's greed and jealousy. But George is the one who's going to take the fall for this mistake. And on top of that, his daughter Zuzu is sent home because she has the sniffles, right? And the despair builds, and George takes it out on the teacher who simply calls to see how Zuzu is doing. And George yells at the teacher, and the husband gets on the phone swearing that he's going to knock his block off if he ever finds him. And George craters. He craters, and he goes for a drink. And sitting there, he offers up a prayer of despair. He admits that he's not a praying man, but he asks God to intervene and to show him what to do. And as he's in this moment of despair, two of his friends try to convince George to go home, and they use his name. They speak his name out loud. And the guy sitting next to George at the bar is the husband to that teacher that he yelled at. And what does he do? But he fulfills his promise and decks George on the face. While on the floor, he kind of touches his bloody lip and says, "That's what I get for praying." He checks to see if his life insurance is still in his pocket, and he heads out to do the unthinkable. But George has a guardian angel, and that angel intervenes, showing George what life would be like without him. And that gives George a renewed sense of hope, and with that hope comes a new lease on life. We consider that movie a treasured classic, right? It's something I know I have to watch every year. It's just tradition in my family. But, you know, we consider it a treasured classic because we've all been there. We've all been there. At one time or another, we have all found ourselves at the end of our rope. We found ourselves having to deal with an uncontrollable mess, and we're teetering on the edge of despair. There is so much that happens in our lives that we do not understand, that we cannot control, and it's frustrating, and it weighs on us. So how do we find any sort of renewed hope? Where do we go to find strength again? Might I suggest that you go back to what Jesus was telling his followers? That you should expect his second coming, that God isn't giving up on you, that God isn't giving up on this world, that in the end, it's going to be all right. And if it's not all right, it's not the end. Remember, we've talked about that before. That's what we have to do. We have to watch with faithful waiting. We have to be on guard. We have to be ready. We have to live ready. And that's why I'm glad we have this season that's called Advent. We don't immediately jump to the stories of Christ's birth. You realize that, right? We didn't read about what happened in Bethlehem on that holy night. No, we spend some time renewing our commitment to Christ and remembering that our hope is in Christ and Christ alone. You better watch out. That's not just a great Christmas song. That's actually excellent spiritual advice. You realize that? Not out of fear. Out of hope. You better watch out. Be on guard. Live ready. Because God is doing a new thing. So during this time of year, we remember the promised birth of our Savior, but we also remember that we live in between times, the beginning and the end. You realize that? We live between the beginning and the end, between the first coming of Jesus and the second coming of Jesus. And why is all of that important? It's important because it means that the future is in God's control. Do you realize that? Do you hear that? If Christ is coming again, then it is a powerful reminder that no matter what happens, even if it is airplanes crashing into buildings and military buildings and into the ground, despite what you might see in this world, even despite the despair that you sometimes struggle with, that I sometimes struggle with, God is still in control. That's why it's so important to remember that Christ is coming again. My friends, that's great news. Is that not? That's incredible. That's wonderful. We don't know when Jesus is coming again. We don't know what tomorrow might bring. But you know, this is what we do know. That the same God who sent this tiny baby to be the Savior of the world 2,000 years ago is still the one who holds all things in his hands. That's God. And because of that, my friends, we can live each day full of faith, hope, and love. We can be confident that Christ is coming again. that God will intervene in the affairs of this world one day. We won't have to worry about presidential elections. Thank you, God. Oh, come, Lord, and intervene in our lives. That's Advent. And we got to be ready for it. We got to be open to it. And above all, we have to believe that all things will work for good for those who love the Lord. Would you pray with me? God of grace and God of all glory, we bless and worship your holy name. We love this time of year and the hope delivered in the city of Bethlehem. And you know, some of us, God, some of us can't carry a tune. Some of us here can't sing, but we will sing your praises. And together with all the company of heaven, we say, worthy is the Lord, and holy is your name. Because you, Lord, have changed our fate. You've given us a future filled with life. You've transformed our weeping into gladness. You've taken our despair and filled us with hope. For the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. We ask for you to use this time of worship to strengthen our lives with your love. Because life is not always easy, and we would rather know your peace than live with our weariness. We want to be guided by your grace rather than by bitterness. We would like to know your lasting joy and not just a moment of happiness. So bless this time of worship and help us to make good preparations to receive Christ our Lord. Help us to be ready to listen for Christ's guiding voice, to believe in his law of love, and to be faithful in living out that love. Father, we pray that you be merciful to the prayers we carry to you this day. And we want to pray, Lord, for Nadine. She's with us this morning. She's, Lord, had a real tough go with some medical issues. And we just pray that you restore health and healing to Nadine. Give her, Lord, the encouragement that Lord, you are with her. Bless her doctors as they care for her and give them the wisdom and knowledge that they need. We want to pray for those who are recovering from COVID. We want to pray for Kristen Carden and ask God that you help her and Levi recover. And we know they're doing better, but encourage them and bring them back to us, Lord, full of health. For Carrie and Roan Wilrich, give that same blessing to them. For Deborah Hall, Lord, she has she found an early detection of cancer, and we pray that you bless the treatments that she's going to be using. Help her, Lord, to overcome cancer, for you, Lord, to remove every cell. Bless her doctors, give them wisdom and discernment in helping Deborah. Let their hands, the hands of those doctors, be the instruments of your grace. For all of these prayers, we give to you, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Well, my friends, just to share a few announcements, somebody in here is celebrating a birthday today. Where is Andy Watson? Andy, did you want to come and share something about this? Because I mean, this is a birthday that we're not going to pass by.
It's not mine.
I think it's important that we take a moment to.
You think we need to take a moment? Okay, I think I'll take a moment here.
Take a moment.
Yes, you did not. There's nothing in the announcements about this, but I think it's a very important day that we have coming up this week. Tomorrow is Nancy's birthday.
Hey. I just want to say thank you, church. I want to say thank you for, again, for the shoe boxes. Dan, it was like 650-something shoe boxes that we sent out a couple of weeks ago. Last Thursday on Thanksgiving Day, there were a lot of volunteers who were here to make and serve Thanksgiving meals. I think it was at least over 450 meals, plates, 450 plates. And I want to say thank you to Misty Touche for coordinating that. I don't know how you buy food for 450 people. I wouldn't even know where to begin. But I want to thank all of you all for coming out to helping plan that, cook, serve. We receive the gratitude of our community. And they say thank you. And I extend that to you all this morning. I want to also remind you that our youth group is meeting this coming Wednesday from 6 to 8. We're going to talk about how to have the best Christmas ever in our youth group over the next several weeks. I want to have you mark your calendars. Ruby is going to be doing another program for us, a Christmas program. And that's coming up on December 19th, so mark your calendars. And if you'd like to help light the Advent candles, you can talk with either Nancy for this service or Heidi for the second service. And in terms of our prayers, Nadine, our prayers continue to be with you. You're on our hearts, and I know you've been through a lot, and we pray that God continue to lead you down a path of healing and new strength. Family, friends, would you also please remember Kristen Carden? If you're so led, reach out to her. You know, she and the whole family had COVID, and they're doing okay. They're doing better, but they need a little love and support. Are there any other announcements, anything else that we need to share for the good of the church? Yeah, next Sunday we're going to do a special Christmas program in worship. We're going to be doing some good singing, Christmas music. Next Sunday, sort of a lessons in carols. Yes, Joy. Okay. Yeah. Absolutely. So we have our Sunday school class and our fellowship hall, and Joanne Hill is going to be continuing on Advent. There was another hand. Yes, Judy. Yeah. So yes, friends, we are responsible for working at Second Chance this week. If you can donate any hours, especially on Friday and Saturday, that would be most appreciative. Anything else? Did y'all have a good Thanksgiving?
Amen.
Are you grateful?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So my friends, let's be grateful and let's sing our closing song, God Almighty, We Are Waiting. Let's stand as we sing together. Friends, go forth now with the strength of this benediction. Go forth and begin the journey of Advent. Know that Christ has come once, but that Christ will come again. So be alert. Stay on your toes and be faithful to the one whose light shines in the darkness, and the darkness shall never overcome it. Go forth in peace and walk as a child of the light. And the blessings of God, Father Almighty, go with you now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.